for who you are. Thank you for what you've done for us. I thank you that you love us, that you care for us, and I thank you that you've given us your word. I ask that you would comfort us and strengthen us today in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Can you imagine living in the medieval times? You ever play that game where you imagine living in a different time in history? I love to do that all the time. I think I would have been really great at like the end of the 19th century, you know, 1800s and three-piece suits in the middle of a hot day and walking around with a cane. I would have fit in great, top hats and all. It would have been fun. I like to watch Time Team. I think I've told you guys about it. It's the nerdiest show in the world, but they just go and they dig an archaeological dig for 3 days and see what they can find. And sometimes they come across these medieval things, and just the normal parts of life are so different. It's hard to imagine how it would have been to do basic things. You know, they find pottery everywhere. Why? Well, there's no such thing as a metal pot. Are you kidding? Are you royalty or something? So you had these clay pots, and when they broke, what did you do? You pitched them out and got another one. So they're everywhere. We don't have that anymore. You know, we were watching one episode, and they were talking about what you had to do to go to the bathroom. Well, that was a different world too, let me tell you. That's one thing that I do love about modern times. The world was so different, and it was also scary back then. There was no 911. There was no safety and security in a lot of places. You lived under the thumb of strong people. And if you stepped out of line or if you got on the bad side of someone, you could be taken out, destroyed. If you found a mighty enemy, you could be wiped out. I just finished a book by Howard Pyle. Has anyone ever heard of Howard Pyle? A writer from the 1800s, and he wrote this book called Men of Steel, and it's about a young man who's sent away to become a squire and to learn to be a knight. And it starts out with this evil man dressed in black, walking into the Lord's manor, grabbing a mace and killing the man's father. And there's nothing he could do about it because this is a strong, powerful man. The whole book is about him getting to the point where he could challenge this same evil man to single combat and defeat him. And it's a wonderful book. I highly recommend it. But, and of course, good wins in the end and he gets the girl too. So it's an excellent book. But that was the way that you had to live back then. Strong people could destroy you, could take away everything that you had, and there was no recourse, no one to call. You lived on the edge of death at every moment, and there was much fear. And even though we're in a softer age right now, and we can get to thinking that maybe we have a soft God, God actually reveals himself differently. You know, in our modern age, unlike those former days, to be a strong man who walks in and gets the business job done with violence is actually something that's attacked nowadays, right? You're supposed to use your words, don't you know? It's the funniest thing I've heard that a few times from parents.
Use your words, Billy.
Anyway, but that's the kind of world we live in now, where you're not supposed to be strong. You're not supposed to stand up and fight. And a God who would be strong and stand up and fight, a God who's a God of war, a mighty warrior who stands with spear in hand and fights against evil, is a God that's not right because he's violent. And don't you know violence is always wrong? I actually had to read papers like that when I was doing my doctoral studies. It got on my nerves. But there's something therapeutic. I'll give you a little hint, if you ever have times like that, you're reading something that's really stupid, wonderfully therapeutic to throw it across the room. Just make sure you don't hit a window or something. But God is different than that kind of image. God is not a God who uses his words, who sits there going, oh no, I don't know what to do. And today in Habakkuk, as we're closing off this book, we get a picture of the God of might, the God who inspires a righteous fear. Why? Because he's not the kind of God who's going to sit by and watch evil do its work. So turn with me to Habakkuk 3. Now you remember, we've gone through the chapter 1 started out with Habakkuk coming and saying, there's evil everywhere, God. What are you going to do? And God says, I'm going to do a mighty work. Do you remember what that mighty work was? Oh man, he's going to smite the evil. No, he's going to send the Chaldeans to burn, to destroy, to wipe people out. Why? Because there's evil in the people of God. Because the people of God are not living how they should. Then in chapter 2, we get a sense of hope. We get a sense of a future. We get a sense that God is at work. And finally, we come to chapter 3, where Habakkuk says, a prayer of Habakkuk, the prophet, according to Shigayonoth. O Lord, I've heard the report of you, and your work, O Lord, do I fear. In the midst of the years, revive it. In the midst of the years, make it known in wrath. Remember mercy. God came from Teman, and the Holy One from Mount Paran. His splendor covered the heavens, and the earth was full of his praise. His brightness was like the light. Rays flashed from his hand, and there he veiled his power. Before him went pestilence, and plague followed at his heels. He stood, and he measured the earth. He looked, and he shook the nations. Then the eternal mountains were scattered. The everlasting hills sank low. His were the everlasting ways. Boy, what a good start. Habakkuk has looked at all that God did, and Habakkuk begins with an honest appraisal of God. He's afraid because God isn't simple or small. God isn't weak or tiny. God's not sitting there in the corner using his words, hoping to convince people. God is mighty. God is fearful. The God of the universe has all power. He is so strong, so powerful that in his very presence, even the mountains run away. He is so strong that he has the power with a look to shake the nations. He is a God of strength, of awesomeness. He is a God whose will be done. But Habakkuk is afraid because that will may not always be his will. Habakkuk looks and he sees a God who will not be trifled with, a God who is truly God in every sense of the word, a God who will do all things and will have his ways be everlasting. This is a God who shines with light, who's mighty and is at work. This is a God who is doing things, not just passively. He's not a God that wound up the world and then walked away and said, well, have fun and play with it. See what happens. This is a God who's intimately involved in every aspect of life, and nothing and nobody can gainsay his will. You think about it. We look at powerful people, or we look at powerful situations. Perhaps we look at the government and we see them as this monolith, this thing that's too great to stand against. And God looks at them and says, are you kidding? The mountains run away when I'm walking by. The nations crumble when I just look at them. Have you ever known someone like that who can scare you with just a look? My dad was like that. It's like the micro version of this, right? Now, some of you guys have met my dad. He's the kindest, greatest, awesomest dad in the world. But you don't mess with him. And we had one day, my brother and I may have told you this story, where we were being boys. We were supposed to be in bed, but you know, we had a bunk bed, and I had a stuffed animal, and he had a stuffed animal. And the good news is, if you take them by the leg, they make a great beating stick. And so we're busy doing this, up and down, beating each other and having a hoot. And I'm sure we thought we were really quiet, but surprisingly, Dad heard us. And all of a sudden, as I was wailing away on Ben, I happened to look over, and there was Dad, just watching, just looking. And all of a sudden, I fled. All of a sudden, I turned to jelly. All of a sudden, I couldn't stand on my knees. And I was going, Ben! Ben! And he was still merrily beating away. But, you know, you try as a child. You're like, okay, maybe we can cover this over if we just do it quick enough, you know, pretend like we're doing everything fine. No, we were caught dead to rights. And the look of the father was enough to turn us to jelly. Well, that's a small, infinitesimal version of what we have when God looks at the nations, when God stands up and God shows himself. Nobody and nothing can look at him and say, oh, I think I'll keep doing what I'm doing. I think I'll just pretend he's not there. God is mighty and his ways are everlasting. We have no idea of something that's everlasting. You know, we can kind of grasp something that's old, right? We can see hills and trees and the shape of the land, and we can say, this has probably been here for a while. But you know what's really interesting? We were digging the sewer line yesterday, and guess what I found at the bottom of the trench and had to dig through with a shovel? I found a gravel bar. You know what that means? At some time in the past, the landscape was different, and there was a stream flowing through there. Again, when I watch my time team, that's one of the things I love the most, is they study and they go, wow, the landscape has changed so much. They'll find a reading of some medieval text and they'll say, you know, the seashore used to be 30 kilometers that way, and it's changed this much in that short period of time. The things that we see as everlasting, unchanging, are actually changing just like that. If we could sit ourselves down in a chair and hit rewind and just watch the world go backwards, we'd be shocked at how much change is all around us. And yet God is unchanging. The same God who before the foundations of the world were built, planned this world, made this world, set his will in stone, is the same God who is walking that will out, working that plan out today in our lives. The same God who was the same yesterday and today and forever is the God we serve. He will not change. And he doesn't bounce around from thing to thing like we do. You know, sometimes I'll start out with one purpose and I'll get distracted. Has that ever happened to you? Sometimes I say that I have a little bit of ADD. I don't know if I do or not. But when I'm reading a book or studying, I call myself an ADD studier because I'll have about 14 books set up. And then I'll go to find this thing. And that'll lead me to this thing. And then that'll take me over here. And that'll take me over there. I get lost in my direction. I get lost in what I'm doing. My will changes because circumstances influence me and shape the way that I'm going throughout the day. You know, I'll be on my way to do something and I'll stop to talk to someone, and an hour later I'll get back to what I'm doing and my wife will be irritated a little bit because I've done the homeschooler goodbye again. You ever heard of that? The homeschooler goodbye. You say goodbye in the house, you say goodbye at the door, you say goodbye at the car, and it takes about an hour to do. But our wills change. Our lives are molded by the world around us. Our intentions shift. Sometimes we have a plan. But what does the scripture say? The man makes his plans and the Lord directs his steps. Sometimes we make a plan and the scriptures say, hey, say if the Lord wills, I'll go here and I'll do that because something's going to change. But you know what the scriptures don't say? They don't say God's doing that same thing. His plan, his will, his ways are utterly and completely unshakable. And nothing and no one has the power to change what he does. And that's a blessing and a curse, right? We can look at that and say, wow, he is stable and solid and sure. He is faithful and above reproach. There will never be a time when he will let us down. And we're excited about that. But then there's this other little problem. It's when my will doesn't agree with his. And then we end up where Habakkuk is, just a little bit afraid, because this is the God who will not change. And so that means I have to. This is the God who will not move, and so he expects me to move in the power of the Spirit. This is the God who is holy and perfect, and so he expects me to conform to his image. And that's frustrating, but so good, isn't it? God is at work. God is striding over the world, and the hills sink low and get out of the way because he's coming through. And that's what we must do as well. We must surrender to him, trust him, trust the work that he's doing in the world. But there's more to it. And this is the part that I really love. I like a good military theme, you know. I don't know if you've noticed that. I like a good war movie. I like a good person who stands up and fights against evil. And here we have verse 7 where it says, I saw the tents of Cushan in affliction. The curtains of the land of Midian did tremble. Was your wrath against the rivers, O Lord? Was your anger against the rivers, or your indignation against the sea when you rode on your horses, on your chariot of salvation? You stripped the sheath from your bow. You called for many arrows. You split the earth with rivers. The mountains saw you and writhed. The raging waters swept on. The deep gave forth its voice. It lifted its hands on high. The sun and the moon stood still in their place as the light of your arrows as they sped. At the flash of your glittering spear, you marched through the earth in fury. You threshed the nations in anger. You went out for the salvation of your people, for the salvation of your anointed. You crushed the head of the house of the wicked. You laid him bare from thigh to neck. You pierced with his own arrows the heads of the warriors who came like a whirlwind to scatter me, rejoicing as if to devour the poor in secret. You trampled the sea with your horses, the surging of mighty waters. Didn't that get you a little bit riled up? This is the God we serve. He's a God who doesn't just stand by, but he's a God who gets in his chariot, grabs his spear, unsheaths his bow, and goes to war against evil. He does not tolerate wickedness. He does not stand by as people are afflicted, but he stands against the enemies of righteousness. He makes them tremble because he's gone to war. This image is one of a great God of war. Not a passive, soft, gentle, use your words God, but a God who will see evil destroyed, who will see unrighteous deeds punished, who will stand up and say no to sin. And to anyone who chooses to be against him, they will find this mighty warrior in his chariot bearing down upon them. And there are two options. You get out of the way or you die. You change or you're lost. The Lord is a mighty warrior and the Lord is on the move. You look at these pictures that he gives. The bow shooting these arrows, destroying those, marching through the earth in fury, threshing the nations in anger. Have you ever seen a threshing machine at work? Those old thrashers? You watch it. You don't want to be inside it. This is what happens when God goes to war. He is beating out evil from this world. And it's not about merely punishing people. It's not about crushing people as some sort of a vindictive, hateful God. It's not the Shiva of the world who's just going around randomly slaughtering. But it is a God who will not tolerate evil, wickedness, who is so holy and righteous, he cannot stand to see evil done, and he will give evil its just deserts. Now, the amazing thing, and we've seen this in this book, is God is a God of grace and mercy, long-suffering and full of loving kindness. But God's loving kindness is about bringing people up out of sin. It's not about winking at sin or saying sin doesn't matter, that being evil doesn't matter. It's not about saying you can just carry on and I hope you have a good time. But he will save people from this. And if people refuse to turn, if people do not step aside from their wickedness, he won't just say, oh, well, I tried. I guess you have fun. Everybody's going to go to heaven anyway. No, he cannot stand evil. It cannot be before him, for he is a holy and a righteous God, and he will destroy it. You look at this image, you pierced with his own arrows the heads of his warriors, and this is what happens with evil. I've said it many times, and I hope you hear it. Sin is poison for the soul. Sin is like taking an arrow, sticking it straight up in the air, shooting it, and waiting to see what happens. It kills us. It destroys relationships. It tears down whole nations. It leads this world to the place of ruin that it is in, and God won't stand it. And God will reward it. And the rewards for evil are horrible. God will give what we deserve. But in an amazing turn too, God gives us something that we don't deserve. God gives us a way to walk with him, to be free from sin, to not have to experience the wrath of this almighty warrior. God came to earth and took this wrath upon himself. That's what he did on the cross. Jesus didn't pray in the Garden of Gethsemane just because he was afraid of a couple of nails sticking in him. He said, take this cup from me, because the cup that he was about to take was all the wrath of God against all sin for all time, and it was going to be poured out upon him in one moment. And just the power of that turned the sky to darkness and caused the rocks to split. And he took it for us. He paid the price for us, because God will not tolerate evil. One of the oldest images in the world is the battle of good and evil, light versus dark, yin and yang. It's there in every tribe and culture. And often it's pictured as a desperate struggle where we don't know the end. But the image that we have of God is not one who desperately struggles against evil, but a conquering warlord who walks through and his enemies flee before him. There is no combat. There is no challenge. There is no question of how it will turn out. He is God, and even the mountains can't stand against him. I love that image in Revelation, where all the armies of evil gather together for one battle. You remember that part, right? They all gather from the four corners of the earth, and it's going to be one of them rock 'em, sock 'em, drag 'em out fights. And then fire falls from heaven and they are destroyed, because that is all the power that evil has in the face of God. It is nothing. The weapons of our warfare are not carnal. Just like Lana was talking about today, the devil is at work. There are spiritual forces at play here and now in Canada. We've unfortunately tried to bury our heads and forget about these things, but they are real and they are here fighting against us. We have the world, the flesh, and the devil as our enemies, and the devil is going strong. And so we do not stand fighting against government, people in this world. We don't stand against the physical things, but we recognize that we are fighting against spiritual forces, and that the only solution is for God to fight our battle for us. We wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against powers and principalities and spiritual forces in the heavenlies. And the weapons of our warfare aren't our fists, a sword, but the sword of the Spirit, the shield of faith, the breastplate of righteousness, the helmet of salvation. These are the ways that we fight. Not by trying to wave signs in front of a legislature. Not by sneakily going out and puncturing the tires of people we don't like. Not by trying to overcome through our own might. But by the power of the Spirit, by trust in God, by living as He's called us, and boldly standing next to Peter and Paul and everyone else and saying, we will obey God not rather than men. We will not allow anything to push us aside from doing what God has called us to do. And what is the message we will preach? Well, there's lots of messages we could preach. But there's one that God has given us, the word of the gospel, the truth of Jesus Christ. This is the sword that we wield, and it is powerful for the pulling down of strongholds. It has the power to defeat all the work of the enemy. Now, does this mean that our bodies will be safe? Or that we'll always have an easy time? Does this mean we're going to float through life on a cloud of good times and be able to pray down a Cadillac whenever we want? Be convenient, but that's not how it works. We may struggle, we may even die. But the God of war, the God who is the mighty God, is always at work through us and in us. He is always doing His will, and no one and nothing can stand against Him. We are not locked in close combat with a question of who's going to win, but we are watching as the God of the universe does His mighty will, striding across the world with the hills, getting out of the way as He comes through. So then what can we do? Well, Habakkuk goes on and he said, I hear and my body trembles. My lips quiver at the sound. Rottenness enters into my bones. My legs tremble beneath me. Yet I will wait quietly for the day of trouble to come upon people who invade us. I see the world around me and I'm afraid, God. I see what you're doing, but I'm still worried and weak. So the only thing I can do is sit down and trust you. The only thing I can do is stand waiting to see what you're going to do. Because this day of trouble is here, I see that. But you are mighty, you are powerful, and you are at work. He goes on to say, though the fig tree should not blossom, nor fruit be on the vines, the produce of the olive fail, the fields not yield food, the flock be cut off from the fold, and there be no herd in the stalls, yet will I rejoice in the Lord. I will take joy in the God of my salvation. God the Lord is my strength. He makes my feet like the deer's. He makes me to tread on my high places. This is the image of Habakkuk's response. First, he trembles in fear because he doesn't want to go through it. He doesn't like what he's going to deal with. But he trembles even more because he looks upon God and he sees a God who cannot be gainsaid, whose will be done, who is the mighty warrior, and he knows he must wait. Perspective is everything. Can you imagine being confronted by an armed robber, having someone pull a gun on you and say, "Give me your wallet"? It'd be scary, wouldn't it? But now compare that to a whole battalion of cavalry charging towards you with swords drawn and flashing, with the hooves making a thunder, with noise all around you as you watch these people bent upon your destruction. All of a sudden you take that armed robber back. This is what Habakkuk is seeing. He says, I see the destruction coming upon us. I see what you're going to do. I know it's not going to be fun in the short term. I know there's going to be pain and suffering. People will lose their lives. People will be without food. There will be desolation. But I know that you are great, and I know that you are at work, and I will trust you in the midst of that. I won't look to my weakness. I won't look to things that are going on around me, but I will look to the greatness of God when you reveal all you are doing. And I will trust in you. I will believe in the power of you. There's powerful things that we can kind of picture. You've seen an avalanche maybe, or a landslide, or you know, perhaps you've watched a volcano erupt, or a hurricane come through. Maybe you've seen a tornado, or watched a tsunami. But all of these rolled into one cannot describe the power of Almighty God. We can't even grasp just a glimpse of His power. And here's Habakkuk saying, I see a little bit and my legs are going to jelly, not because you're not powerful enough, but because I'm afraid of what's going to happen, because I know you are powerful. But when he takes stock of God's work, when he finally stops to trust him, he doesn't walk away going, I'm afraid and therefore I'm going to turn. He walks like Job and says, though he slay me, yet will I worship him. Can we accept good from God and not ill? Can we not trust God that he will only give us what we need? And if that is the case, then should we not rejoice in the Lord? Should we not take joy in the God of our salvation? Should we not look to God who has our strength? This final piece is so important. He makes my feet like the deer's so that I may tread on the high places. You ever seen a mountain goat or a deer run up the side of a mountain? You ever see them just kind of dancing where if we tried to walk, we'd fall for sure? They're utterly unafraid. They know they are sure-footed no matter what. I saw a video of a goat climbing a palm tree, just walking up it. And I was amazed. They're so sure-footed. They're so able to go where you couldn't imagine. And this is what God does to us. He doesn't smooth out all the paths and make it so that it's perfectly flat and level and that us little hothouse flowers can just kind of mince along on our way to heaven. He takes us and he gives us the ability to go through the difficult times, the struggles, the trials, the high places, those steep, craggy cliffs, the places where if we had just a breeze come by, we'd fall off and collapse to our death on the sharp rocks below. And he makes us waltz through that, not because of our strength, but because of what he gives us in his Spirit. So in the midst of the pain, the sorrow, the suffering, the destruction that we see all around us, we can say, I put my trust in his strength. I put my trust in the God of my salvation, and I will walk with hind's feet in the high places because I know my Redeemer lives, and I know I shall see his face, and I have nothing to fear in this world. This is what he does for us. Though there may be no food, though there may be no safety, though we may never have a day's rest on this earth, we will walk through it in confidence with him. We'll end up like Paul and Silas, sitting there in prison, chained so we can't even scratch our nose, and praising God because we can't wait to see what he's going to do in and through us. This is the God we serve. God is at work, and God is at war. So we can rejoice. He makes my feet like a deer's and makes me tread on the high places. He will give me that ability and he will never let us down. God is always trustworthy, and in these times of turmoil, terror, and torture, he will always be with us. He will never leave us or forsake us. He will carry us through and give us strength by the Spirit, so that we may trust in the God of our salvation. We can say boldly, whom shall I fear? We can say boldly, a mighty fortress is our God, a stronghold never failing. We can stand and look at all that the world is going to do to us and say, I don't care, because God is good. That doesn't come from a false place of having to put on a smile on our face and pretending like everything's okay. We can be scared. Our legs can be turning to jelly. Our bones can feel like they're rotting away because we're utterly and completely incapable of doing what we should. But we can cling to our God and trust him. And he will always be trustworthy. He will always be faithful. And we cannot bear this tide without a close walk with our God, who's our strength. We cannot bear this tide unless we have him putting strength back into our bones when they turn to jelly. We need him. So CCF, are you anxious about the future today? Are you worried? Are you fearful? Are you struggling? Here's a good news. It's okay. You don't have to be perfect before God is going to do things. You don't have to be worried that somehow you can muck up his will. You don't have to be doubtful because maybe something you did threw everything off and now your whole world is going to be cast into disaster. God has you in his hand. God knows, and God is at work for you. So if you're anxious about the future today, give it to him. Stop and think about it. Remind yourself who he is and that you can trust him. Are you prepared then for the trials, the tribulations, the temptations, and the outright terrors that are coming your way? Are you prepared to stand for the Lord when others around you will not? Are you prepared to believe that being with him is better than to have 1,000 at each of your sides? Are you looking totally to the God of your salvation for the strength to carry on and to get through each and every day? And are you trusting this mighty warrior to fight your battles for you? Finally, are you ready to say with Habakkuk, I'll wait quietly for the day when God is going to do his work? Let's pray. Lord God, I thank you so much that you are a mighty warrior, that you are at work, that you are powerful and righteous, and that you will do your will. Help us, O God, to see your work. Help us to trust in you. Strengthen our arms that we may stand. Help us, O God, to walk with you, to place our trust in the God of our salvation. We praise you and we glorify you for all that you have done for us. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.